Thank you, Tony, for that beautiful entrance. You're getting a round of applause from many of us, and a warm welcome to everyone to the GAIA Journey 2021. It's wonderful to all come together in this way. My name is Antoinette, and I'm standing on Lenape land, what's known as Cortland Manor, New York. With the Hudson River on one side, the mountain on the other. And I'm very happy to be greeting you from this place that I've been really in for the last year. And I've been in this place for a little longer than that, but I feel like I've really nested here and really landed here. Sometimes I find it a little miracle that as a human being, my feet can even leave the soil. So with that, I also pass it to Oral McGuire, who's a respected Nyungar leader from Western Australia, who is also holding this session with us. And I feel that it's 9 a.m. here in New York, it's 9 p.m. here there for him. And I feel like collectively we are with him and the holding team, we're kind of holding this global energy of this conversation on our collective connection to soil. So I'll turn it over to you, Oral, for our opening.
Lovely. Thank you, Antoinette. Can everybody see the screen that I've just shared? Great.
Yeah.
Hey, Awanju, thank you and welcome, I guess, to everybody. I am a Mangara Baladong Wajuk Nyungar, so I am a Southwest Aboriginal person, First Nations person, and I am sitting here in the traditional, the very powerful traditional lands of the Wajuk people in Australia, the southwest of Australia. I just want to share with everybody to start the evening for us, or the day off, the morning, with a Nyungar philosophy about the trilogy of our existence, the trilogy of being. Buja is a concept word for country or universe. It's about the existence of who we are and where we come from. Mort is our concept for kinship structures and cultural law. It's the blueprint for the way that we connect with each other and everything in a systemic and systematic way. And Cutajan is our the concept word that we use for our knowledge systems. Our old people spoke a beautiful language, and when we say that when we speak that language, it resonates with the spirit of the land. And our old people used that language and spoke in such ways. They were one name people. So the introduction of English names and surnames is a new development for Nyungar and Aboriginal people, First Nations people of Australia. So this is just a little bit about that was left to me by an old brother who passed away last year. His name was Seelan Garlett. He was a Nyungar Bulyat Abirdia. He was a boss man from our cultural law and cultural family. And this was a story that he told, and it was his grandmother and my grandmother were sisters. His grandmother's surname, and full name was Yurleen, and mine was Dubach. One of our grannies, Yurleen, used to say that this was to be passed on to her children and her grannies. There are places where you find serenity, where you find a sense of belonging, that this is part of our place. And these places become a part of our area, our spirit and our culture. We call this whole concept Buja. In our language, we say Nitya Buja Kunyan, Nitya Kurbarangi Buja, Kalak Maya Kunyanwa. Demanga Mamunga Wern Kaya Murta Kunyan. Demanga Mamunga Nunakut Buja Kunyan Kala Kulin. Kulanga Borda Nyen and Nyen Balapa Wern Nitya Buja Barang. These words say that this is my country where I belong. This is Demangal Mamangat, my grandmother and my grandfather's land. This is their land where their spirits now move. Buddha, or later on, this is going to be the responsibility of my children and my children's children. Their home and this place will always be linked to their spirit. Thank you.
Thank you, Oral. Thank you for sharing that. And we look forward to hearing more of your story just a little further on in the session. So a reminder, as we begin to just sense into our own place where we may have been, I know that there is a lot happening in our world. And some of that may mean that we've been locked down or in some sort of connection to our space for the last year or more. And the GAIA journey really was born from that place as well. So 1 year ago, we came together for our first session of the Global Activation of Intention and Action. We already had a global community in a lot of different ways, but this way of connecting was new for some of us, and coming together to really hear the wisdom of leaders and teachers in their places and spaces around the world. So thank you, Oral, for sharing that and for connecting us to the thread of your ancestors and your people. And I'm reminded also of the session that we had last year with Vandana Shiva, who shared with us a great few teachings that, you know, she's been working on for the course of her lifetime in the last few decades, and just the connection to the Indigenous reminder of the fight for the commons and the taking responsibility for our land and for our connection to the land as human beings and what that actually means. So these two sessions of the GAIA journey today are going to dive into that and explore that a bit more. So connecting to the threads that Vandana started with us last year and connecting forward into the conversations that we will have throughout these two sessions and in the Global Forum on June 15th and 16th. So we look forward to that connection and conversation and to land us further in this space and the connection. I turn it over to our partners, Pieter Ploeg at Commonland, who will take us into a first activity. Pieter, over to you.
Thank you, Antoinette. And I think it's so beautiful how Oral has helped us to connect to our land. And there are so many ways in which we are connected that we may not be always putting our awareness into. And I want to invite you along on an exercise to do some reconnecting. So just invite you to sit up straight and with your feet on the ground and bring your attention to food that has come into your body. And as we're spanning the globe, that may be recent dinner, that may have been your lunch, that may have been your breakfast, but just bring your attention to your most recent food intake. try to remember what that was. And then feel free to share in the chat, what is it that you took? What is it that nourished your body? What is it that gives you the energy to focus on this space today? Feel free to just put words in the chat describing some of the ingredients: bread with avocado, raw carrots with hummus, lemon water, coffee, muesli, oats and egg. Well, there we go. Carrots, coffee, apples, sunflower seeds, bananas. I can't even keep up. Wonderful. Thank you so much. And as a next sort of layer in our food intake and that which nourishes us, try to tune in with what did it take for that food to arrive for you to be able to take it into your body. So where did you purchase that food? Where did you go and collect that food? Where did it come from? What was the point from which it arrived into your home, onto your fork, into your hands? A local food market, supermarket, local store, another room, grocery shop, patisserie, an organic box, a local market. And now we're going to deconstruct it a little bit. So how did that piece of food, that particular piece of food, arrive at that place? How did it land on the supermarket shelf? How did it end up at the local market? Someone saying my garden. What's the step before that? Where did that particular piece of food or drink originate from? Let's see what's coming up in the chat. Got it from a producer, village farmer, local farmers. Industry, factory, very far away, garden, Ethiopia, a local fisherman, beautiful. Thank you so much. So let's try to imagine that somewhere there's this producer or fisherman. Let's stick with the producer or the farmer. So that particular food, maybe it's a carrot, maybe it's an apple for this exercise. The nutrients that are feeding you right now, that are giving you that energy, where did that particular piece of food get that energy from? How did that come to be? The sun, the water, the air, the rain, and yes, of course, Mother Earth and our soil. And this is just a beautiful exercise to see how actually in our life we are connected to the soil in a very cyclical way. And you could almost see that as the shape of a landscape. As we take that food into our bodies and as it cycles through our bodies, and it's given back to nature where it's cycled again through the soil to nourish us again in the future. And this ever-going cycle, in that way, we are eating the soil in that way. We're eating the nutrients. We're taking in the calcium, magnesium, and iron that's in the soil. And the reason why that's in the soil is from the other side of the cycle. And one beautiful notion that I've found in my journey is that on both sides of that landscape, there are millions of microorganisms that are stewarding that process. So our gut microbiome is full of microorganisms that are helping us to take those nutrients from that food and nourish our bodies. And at the other side in the soil, just a teaspoon of soil may hold more life, more microorganisms than there are human beings on this earth. This is just a little exercise for us to just reconnect with that cyclical motion. Every time we take that bite of food, we are connected to the soil and the life in that soil and the plants and other beings on that soil. So with that, I'll pass on to Otto. Thank you so much for joining me in this exercise.
Thank you, Peter. And hello, everyone. I'm joining you here from the land of the Massachusetts, the Boston area. And Peter, what you just did resonates so much. So helping us to draw our attention on the actual relationships that we have with planet Earth, that we have with the land, that we have with Mother Nature. And I also want to express my profound gratitude, Oral, to you kind of for joining us in this session, for co-holding this session, and for guiding us through this session. And what you spoke about at the opening very much connects to to the intention, I should say, maybe, that many of us bring into this session. And you spoke about the spirit of the land and how our own spirits and the spirits of our ancestors relate to the spirit of place and the spirit of the land. And that is also very much something we want to, we hope to investigate more in our own context, kind of that each of us in this session brings. As Antoinette mentioned, kind of with the opening of GAIA just a year ago, and as many of you will know, the essence of really the GAIA inquiry and the essence of the presencing work is about bridging the three divides, bridging something that we sometimes frame as the three divide, the ecological divide, the social divide, and the spiritual divide, our disconnect to nature, our disconnect to each other, and our disconnect to ourselves, to our own highest future possibility. And when often there is a lot spoken about the disconnects in the social realm, and one concept that we all know that has been very useful there to really put our arms around what is actually happening and where are our blind spots is the concept of violence. And the distinction in particular between direct violence, so violence I can inflict directly through my actions on another person, structural violence, so violence, for example, through our economic relationships, right? There is an unequal exchange and there is suffering on one side of an economic equation that is not connected with directly with one individual, but with the whole web of economic relationships. So that's structural violence. And then there is something that I have proposed to maybe pay attention to, attentional violence at the root of the other two. Attentional violence as the violence that we inflict on others by not seeing them in terms of who they really are. And of course, as we all know, attentional violence can also be directed against ourselves, right? We can also be not seeing, attending to ourselves in terms of who we really are. So it goes both ways. And what I would invite us into for this session and also the second session we have later today is to maybe investigate these distinctions in terms of our relationship to nature, to Mother Earth, to planet Earth. When you think about the first one, the direct violence, well, the fracking, right? The terrible fracking that's happening here in the United States and in other places. That's just one of so many examples there. Structural violence. So if you, and we'll get into that later today, structural violence is really when you look into our relationship with food, right? Because it is a direct physical relationship, but I can have a relationship with food that is regenerating the earth, or have a relationship with food that is, you know, part of a cycle that is actually harming the earth. And so that's the structural dimension. But Oral, what you were talking about kind of on the third dimension, which is attentional violence. So where is it? So we are somewhat aware of the first two levels of violence, but how is it that we can inquire in our very own personal sacred relationship with planet Earth, not only as a living system, but also as a living being? And that has its own spirit, as you were sharing with us, Oral, in your opening remarks. So that's the invitation for both of this session to lean deeper into these into the relationship that we have with our planet, not only, you know, in terms of the direct and structural, but also in terms of the attentional dimension. With that, I hand it over to you, Dieter.
Thank you, Otto. I hope you all hear me and see me. And thank you first, Otto, for framing this and Peter bringing my attention to the food we eat and where it comes from, and Oro for the beautiful words you brought in. So I'm Dieter van den Broeck. I'm a full-hearted EU practitioner, and as well, I work for an organization called Commonland. And as Commonland, our vision or our dream is really to see a world where restoring ecosystem, restoring our soul, and restoring the connection to our ecosystem can become a new norm and can really help us to reconnect to ourselves, each other, and our landscape, and really bridging these three divides. And how do we do that as Commonland is to really try to build large-scale restoration programs with a business case or for returns business case. We do that from a really big belief that we can do that. When we put our attention and focus to it, we can restore large-scale ecosystems. And there are a lot of beautiful examples around the world. One of them is in China, done by the World Bank, the Chinese government, where they took a landscape the size of France and restored it from a desert to a green desert, even visible now from satellite imagery. And this providing a lot of benefits for the communities there and the ecosystem and the economy around them. And what we as well believe as Commonland and what we observe is on the one side is that when we have degraded landscapes and we have bad land management, we really lose purpose and hope on those landscapes, a loss of employment, a loss of biodiversity, and also economic activities. Well, again, when we work together and put our attention to it, we can really restore those landscapes. One, to bring back natural capital, so biodiversity, as well as sequestrate a large amount of carbon to mitigate climate change. Because of that, we will have less flooding, less droughts, less fires and natural disasters, and all other kind of ecosystems, what this healthy ecosystem provide to us. It will create social capital, more ecopreneurs, more jobs in those areas, but as well create a social cohesion. And for me, the one that inspires me the most is a return of inspiration. And I believe that by bridging those three divides, what Otto is talking about, we really can kindle a fire in humans to really start doing the right thing, to give them a purpose and hope to start developing those other capitals on the landscape. The other thing that we really observe around the world and really would like to invite you as well around is on a surface level, we know what is not going well on our earth, but on the surface level as well, there is so much amazing work around. I've been traveling the world, and when you look in your own community, you will see amazing farmers do regenerative agriculture, permaculture, agroforestry, amazing NGOs restoring the land. So it's a lot of initiatives trying to do that, but they need our support to be able to scale them. On the other side, what we see is that there is a lot of beautiful regulations coming out in Europe, Green New Deal, the UN decade of restoration, big companies who want to invest in that. So there is a lot of that as well happening. Carbon marketing is happening. But what we really need now is a shift of paradigm of thought. And my CEO, Willem Ferreira, always says we need to shift from a maximalization of profit to profit per hectare to really into a maximization of diversity per hectare, or for returns or more values per hectare. And to do that, as you all know, what we need is a paradigm shift where we work together from an ego to an eco paradigm. And therefore we're partnering with the Presence Institute and facilitate multi-stakeholder learning journeys where we bring different stakeholders together to really start co-creating and dreaming together around the possibilities to create that at scale. And this is some pictures of a project we're doing in Spain where we took farmers and the community through a EU process where they're really now developing. On one side, they have an agriculture association with 400 farmers, and they're setting up their own business, regenerative almond business. The same we're doing in South Africa and in the Netherlands with Welland, but as well with the Harvest of Tomorrow. But as well, a beautiful project we're doing is in the wheat belt in Australia. And on the one side, what we did, was we helped White Oak Pan Agriculture to be listed on as a for returns company, and they're developing dirty clean food. But the other project we're working together with is around dandruff cooling. And I'm really honored and grateful that I can walk and learn from that process. And we're really doing that with two dear friends and colleagues, Katie and John, who are somewhere in this Zoom. And I want to give them the word a little bit about their journey and what they're doing, and then as well introduce Oral as our further speaker. So I hand it over to you, Katie.
Thank you so much, Dieter, for your introduction and for your beautiful opening, Oral, and Antoinette and Otto for that framing. I have to say it's wonderful to sort of feel my feet here on Wadandi Noongar Bujal, and just to imagine all of your feet on the ground of your places connecting us all at this point in time, and to know that we're all here to think about and reimagine how we work with our soil. So I have the very humbling job of introducing Dandru Cooling. I'm one of a very big team, and most of that team are currently asleep or in their PJs. So they've asked me to introduce it tonight and to introduce the rather amazing Oral McGuire. We'd really like to thank Commonland for your support and deep seeing of the work. Because of what you've been able to see in us, you've enabled so much positive change to happen. Many of you have heard about Dandru Cooling already, but I just wanted to touch on it for those of you who don't know. So Dandru Cooling started a couple of years ago, and it's a large-scale Aboriginal-led systems change project with a lot of others of us following and supporting wherever we can. Dandru Cooling in Noongar, and Oral, you can correct this when you step in very soon. It loosely translates to walking together. And in this case, we're walking together towards 2029, which is our 200 years of colonization. So we feel like this is a really important date to really reimagine how are we walking there together, and what is it that we want this place to be when we get there. Therefore, Dandru Cooling is really about decolonizing and rehumanizing everything that we do. And we're really lucky. So we believe that we can bring together a global, best practice in systems change and this amazing network. But we have 80,000 years plus of deep systems knowledge here. When you look at what was here, and it hasn't been disrupted for very long, less than 200 years here. So it's a very unique situation to be in. So when you look at that and you realize that actually what was here, just less than 200 years ago, we had one of the most egalitarian, most sustainable societies anywhere on the planet. So the fact that we can learn from this and understand this and bring this wisdom into what we're doing now really gives us a lot of hope. And a lot of this work is really holding space to really move from a system which we see as actually destroying country, destroying sort of human hearts and souls, to actually one that cares for everything. And for those of you, you might have already met some of the leaders of Dandru Cooling. So you might have met Noel Nanup or Rich Wally, Colleen Hayward and Carol Innes. And there are many others that are leading us on this journey, including Oral McGuire. And they've very much asked him to be the one that leads anything on the topics of food, land or fire. So we're so lucky to have him here tonight. And I have to say, it feels like a really big honour to be introducing Oral. He is a very well-respected Noongar leader, almost impossible to get hold of because his schedule is so busy. So I feel like maybe 9 p.m. on a Thursday night was the one time we would have been able to catch you. And as well as being a well-respected Noongar leader, he's also an expert in shifting systems. So he'll be spending a lot of time tonight talking about how he's actually regenerated over hundreds of acres of land and really brought this to life, all within the span of a decade. So it really gives you a sense of what's possible when you give the control of a piece of land to those who have the best knowledge of how to regenerate it. But as well as that, what it particularly impresses me about Oral is, as well as, you know, having this living example, he's always trying to figure out how to shift the mindsets, the policies, the systems, the structures around that particular place. So as well as sometimes we wonder how he manages to do all of these things, but as well as regenerating this piece of land, he's also chair of the Nyungar Land Enterprise Group, which has eight land holding groups that are a part of that to really strengthen that collective. And that's a quickly growing number as well. He's also one of the founding directors of the Nyungar Chamber of Commerce and Industry, which really seeks to bring in much more aligned practices of commerce with human beings and with Budja, the planet. There's a list that I can go on and on with, but he's also really activated a number of Aboriginal-led large-scale projects around large-scale infrastructure processes. They've really delivered really special results. So I hope at some point you get to hear about all of those. Tonight we're going to ask Oral to share a little bit about his journey of regenerating this piece of land. I have been there, and as soon as you step onto this piece of land, you know that it has been brought back to life, that it has spirit, and there's a place that can heal you as well as a place that has been healed. So Oral, over to you to share whatever you think is important for us to hear tonight.
Thank you, Katie. Thank you for that very warm and long introduction, but it is great to be here. I have a number of slides and I apologize, but I just think that 20 minutes to speak about some of my stuff is really obviously quite challenging for someone like me. I often tell people that lucky my mum actually gave me the name Oral. I was actually named after an American evangelist. So obviously I was meant to speak, maybe that's it. But look, what humbles me is the journey that I've traveled and reconnecting back to my Budja, back to country, reacquiring. And those of you that may or may not know the history of Australia and who we are as Indigenous peoples, our cultures go back to the beginning of time. We are a multinational peoples in Australia. There were 300 nations, 600 language groups within those nations. And our sacred knowledge and our ability to care for some of the harshest places on earth in this continent that we call Australia was managed very sustainably. In fact, in Australia today, the only sustainable model and models are Aboriginal models, are First Nations Australian, First Australians. So I represent the Nyungar people. That's my language group. It's part of the country that I come from. And I just want to share with you some of the journey that I've been traveling. I am also a professional firefighter. I did 18 years service as a professional firefighter, but I left that service in 2007 and re-entered my journey to reconnect to country, which reconnected me to traditional burning, our cultural way of caring for country. So I want to speak about fire. I think is such a critical part, because there's such a strong paradigm shift that's needed in how people think about not only fire, but water, the land. And I know that we're speaking about the soil tonight or today. And so the management of country is so important. And in this place here that we call Australia, on our traditional lands in the southwest, fire was such an important part that contributed so much to the health of the soil, but more importantly, contributed to the very strong ecological health of our plants and our natural systems. So I'm just going to just get this started with sharing this. There we go. So in our language, we say karla kany, karij kany, and bojara kany. That means that fire is sacred, knowledge is sacred, and country is sacred. And we burn country for a whole number of reasons these days. Our fire practices and our land management practices have been removed from us because we've actually had, through colonization, we've been disempowered and disengaged and removed from country and taken away from us our cultural authority to care for the land. And in that time, we've seen so much degradation, so much abuse, and so much loss of spirit, loss of health and well-being of the land itself. So this is Aboriginal Australia as it looked 190 years ago or 200 years ago. And our country is this southwest corner. This is Nyungar country, and there are 14 language groups that make up the Nyungar nation. So the Balladong people and the Whadjuk people are the connections for me. This is that section of Nyungar Bujar, as we call it. And this is what we've survived as a people. We've had 186 years, closer to 190 now, of colonization, oppression, intergenerational trauma, and the consequences of that history. And we've survived that by holding on to what we could, our traditions, our principles, and each other. And that was a statement made by Justice Wilcox, who was presided over the settlement, the battle for the Southwest in our native title. So our native title is just moving through. And what's important in the context of this slide is that Nyungar people now started a process just at the end of last year to now move towards reconnecting and repossessing our traditional lands. This diagram I just want to speak about is important. And I guess I just want to acknowledge what Otto was saying earlier about the violence and the traumas associated with disconnection. And for Nyungar and Aboriginal people in Australia, and I think Indigenous peoples globally, this sense of knowing, belonging, and having a spiritual connection is such a critical part. I've already spoken about Buja, Mort, and Karijan. And in our context, these are central. We actually have a saying, Ngalap Nga Nityo Buja, that this mother, this land is our mother, and we come from it. And in our language, Buja is the concept of country, of land, of universe. And when our women are pregnant, in our language, they are Bujari. So our languages provide us with codes. Our old languages provide us with codes about how our old peoples cared for land. This slide is about our kinship structure that was very much holistic. It was a complex social structure. There were three layers of connectivity within it, and there were three dimensions of interconnectedness. Our bloodline, which is Ngop, was a biological family connection that every culture and every society understands and knows. The people you're related to, your blood connection, your belonging, and your cultural authority for us flows through that connection of blood and kin. The MARP is the skin connection. It's a non-blood connection. So I guess the best understanding that most people would understand in understanding what MARP and skin groups are is when you marry someone, you actually become part of another family that you're not by blood connected to, but through marriage, they are your family also. And then we have the third layer, which is the Borunga system, our totem system, which connects us as human beings to everything in our natural world. The sky, the sea, the plants, the fish, the birds, the animals, the soil itself, become part of our totemic system, which connects us to those places as humans and as people from country, to all aspects of that natural system and that natural world. Nyungar people understood country, and we had six seasons here that allowed us to do all of these things. Our old people managed the land with fire. Our understanding of caring for the biodiversity, caring for the sustenance, and having that proficient resource management knowledge and that ability to keep that unique balance was the critical part, and it's how we sustained ourselves through understanding our six seasons, which were more about understanding that we needed to move across country in a sustainable way and in a practical way, and not set your residence and then stay on one place and then overutilize those resources. So yes, we were criticized as being nomadic and non-agricultural, but our functional way of connecting to country allowed us to move across those sacred parts of our land that gave us connection through our bloodlines and through our totemic systems. We share knowledge all the time, and it's a critical part for us to continue. These days, cultural survival for Indigenous peoples around the globe is our biggest threat. And so holding on to our old culture and our old ways is a real threat. It's a real challenge. And for many of us, it's the most important thing. Nyungar and Aboriginal people shared song lines. Those song lines traversed the country completely. Any of you that know and have seen the southwest, the country that I'm speaking about in Western Australia, would understand that this also looks like a roadmap. And that's exactly how the colonizers used our people when they settled and colonized, that they took the men and made them traverse the country. And as they went across country, they used and mapped it. They used that knowledge in a way that the roads then were developed. Biodiversity is the manifestation of spirit. So we are part of that. As Katie said in her introduction, Aboriginal people see themselves as the carers of everything. Our unique species are in many ways, and in many, many species, are only found here in the southwest. We have thousands of species that are of that uniqueness that are only found in our corner of the world. And when a species passes in our cultural ways, we lose species all the time, particularly with fires and the drying climates in our country are the impacts of global warming and climate change. So when our species become extinct, in our culture, we can no longer sing the song for that totem, for that Wurrunga, for that spirit anymore. And so our songs and our traditional knowledge vehicles that we use, we also cannot sing those songs. So are we prepared or capable in understanding that to decolonize our mind, we need to see fire, for example, as not as a threat, but as a friend? And Aboriginal peoples in Australia absolutely saw fire as a friend. We empower our young people. These young guys here were a group of young Aboriginal firefighters who we trained and we taught to have respect, have that very strong respect to understand fire in order to fight fire. And so it was an important part of their learning. Teaching our young people is important. These are my three beautiful daughters, and I teach our kids that fire is not, as you can see, they are not wearing PPE. They are not, we didn't have on this day firefighting units and equipment. So fire in managing land is an important part. DBCA is our Parks and Wildlife Department over here in Australia in the southwest. They have a management plan that sets targets for them to burn 200,000 hectares of country every year. And their plan is to do that in the cycle of 6 years. I just want to acknowledge Kelby's work here. And Kelby came down and worked with us through Commonland. And this was her description of the conversations that we were having about the massive fires that we had in 2019. I guess the key part there is that Aboriginal people manage fire and use cycles of creation. With all of the capitalism, the industrialization, the rising temperatures, the impacts of mismanagement was done as, and we see them today as cycles of actually of destruction. So the massive global impacts is being felt very much in the destructive fires that we are seeing. Buja, our country actually needs us, and it's a collective. So as Aboriginal people, we talk about how science and our sacred knowledge can actually work together. How can the Western world grow value and respect for our old world and bring it together in a way that we actually give the focus to Buja? We make Buja our number one. Country becomes our focus, and then country will sustain us if we follow those basic principles. This was a destructive fire down in the southwest in Binjara country, in Bibbulmun country. And this fire, as you can see in the background, are the Stirling Ranges. Now, the Bibbulmun people are the people, the traditional owners. They're Nyungar, and their identity comes from the land itself. So Mother Earth, in this image, you can see her lying in the background. She is getting tired, and the damage being done with wildfires and the way that land management is happening is destroying not only the ecology, but the ability for this land to feed us, to nurture us, and to sustain us. And that was a powerful image that I took a couple of years ago. I just had to take that photo. So we want to talk about starting a new fire. And those fires, as Katie knows, I've been speaking about sitting around the fire and having these conversations with people. I use the analogy of fire because our old people used fire for so many things. Obviously, as an old culture, it was the source of warmth for cooking and other living uses. But today, those fires and the sacredness of fire is very important. Karl Naring is spirit fire. It's the fire that we use to heal land. And as you can see, we talk about it as being a cool fire. So this is a fire that I was actually standing in when I took this photo, and it had passed through these areas in the foreground. So it doesn't burn everything. It actually trickles through country. It's an important part of healing the land. Now, there's a wrong way fire. This is a fire that started and the soil was absolutely destroyed. It was cooked. You can see the height of the fire, the flames, and how it destroyed everything around it. So in our traditional cool burning ways, this is the type of fire that we apply, where the fire has passed this tree and has literally left it untouched. So there's a different way that we view fire, both as a resource and as a tool. Condition, decondition and recondition is a cycle on country. When we understand it, it helps us understand that fire is so important to the land in Australia. This fire is cooked, this country here. It's destroyed the biodiversity, it's destroyed animals, plants, biota, and other bigger species of trees and plants. This is country that's regenerated, and that sort of country, when burned the proper way, looks like that. So it doesn't take such a long time. It doesn't destroy it, and it takes a much shorter time to regenerate, and it regenerates far healthier. Our country in the southwest looks like this. It is overgrown. The fuel loadings are really bad, and we need to apply fire, cool fire, regularly and differently. In our culture, we speak about country being sick, which makes us sick because we are so spiritually connected to this country and this land and the lands that we call ours, that we come from. And anybody that knows anything about the health and well-being of Aboriginal people in Australia, we are amongst the most unhealthy people on earth. And yet we were the original affluent society. So I just want to show you a quick idea of what a culture of a cool burn is. We're standing in this fire, and you can see that regenerating country and regenerating soil is really important. So this is a photo of our property, the 2,100 acres that we've been working on for the last 12 years, my family and myself. And this is what it looked like in 2008. It was an exploited piece of land for agricultural farming, and it was overgrazed, overcropped, overcleared, obviously. This was all thick bushland, but this is what it looked like in 2008. And it was not good. It was not healthy. In this photo, I just want you to focus on there's a granite boulder. There's this hill, and there are these clump of trees here, because that's what it looked like in 2008. And this is what it looked like back in early March. So this place, through the management of ourselves as Nyungar people, and traditional owners or custodians for the land itself, we've created a sacred site here. This place is manifested in some very strong cultural, spiritual aspects of the land that now allows us to reconnect and heal ourselves. So it's more than food. It's actually food for our souls, is how we view the country itself. I guess that's just a statement that I wanted to make, that learning and sharing knowledge is important. This is another photo from a different part of our property. And again, it now looks like that. I just want to finish with, so in Australia, there was a gentleman by the name of Bill Gammage who wrote the book, The Greatest Estate on Earth, which was about how the British, the English people saw the landscape here in both Nyungar country, but across the southern parts of Australia that they settled first. And he wrote the book that was called The Greatest Estate on Earth. So the question, and this is another shot of our property, can we recreate the greatest estate on earth? And my view is that we're running out of time. In fact, we may have in many ways run out of time, but the opportunity for us to do that is still there, and some significant changes really need to be made if the earth is going to regenerate itself through our support and through the work that all of us, I'm sure, are committed to. And I think we need to see the power shifts. That to me is the greatest challenge. So with that, I'm going to hand back to Antoinette, and thank you.
Thank you, Oral. I am deeply moved by what you shared, and what's needed from us now to decolonize our minds, to be with what you shared, and as was shared in your slide, you said when we share, don't take our knowledge, walk with us. And I'd like to find a way to hold that now with this group of over 500 of us around the world, and find a way that we might walk with you now. So maybe just for a moment, we can sit together. And to do that, perhaps we start with just feeling our feet on the earth. Just in our own place, connecting the feet to the ground. And if you'd like to close your eyes or lower your gaze, if that feels comfortable for you, just connecting in with the images that we've just seen, the words that were just shared. And in this moment, I'm struck by the image that Oral shared of Mother Earth getting tired. Just feeling for a moment, in whatever way our feet are connected to the land. And then connecting around the heart space and just feeling what that feels like. Just tuning into the sensation and the feeling, perhaps, of what we've done to our Earth Mother. And allowing ourselves to be with both the pain of the violence that Otto talked about earlier, and the possibility that Oral shared with us. That the land is food for our souls. And what's possible if we can start a new fire. In our role as human, being connected both to earth and to sky, letting the breath move through. And as we stay here in this reflection space, invite Tony in to connect us with the pain and possibility of this moment through the music that he shares with us. Thank you, Tony. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tony, for just accompanying us with this music as we sit with everything that has been shared. And just before we go into breakouts, we just like to invite you to journal on a couple of questions to just capture what has come up for you. So if you need to, please grab pen and paper or whatever you need to journal as we move into a little journaling practice. So tuning into whatever has just come up in this moment of grounding and music, connect to what it is that you've noticed in yourself from the story that we've heard, from oral story. What did you notice in yourself from the story we heard? Please just write that down for yourself. What did you notice? Those beautiful reflections already in the chat. And we'll slowly move into the next question, which is, where in what you've noticed do you see emerging future? Where is that crack of light, where is that crack where the light comes in? Where do you see emerging future in what you've heard? And as reflections are flowing into the chat, and maybe also flowing out of your pen onto your paper, we're moving on to the last question before our breakouts. What is your highest aspiration on regenerating the land? What is your highest aspiration on regenerating the land?
Thank you, Peter. And as you've already seen, you know, this global dialogue is a bit more than just listening to inspiring stories, although that has sparked so much for our Starting a Fire. What also continues to add more kindling to this fire is each of our voices and being able to share with one another. So we will now turn to breakouts and turn to each other and really just activate this deep listening that we've already been sharing, but turning that towards each other and giving each other the gift of really listening to one another and what's coming up. That said, we don't have all the time in the world to do it, so we'll do that within 12 minutes or so in small groups. So you can introduce yourself, share where in the world you are right now, and just an insight that may have come up for you about the session so far, something that you may be moving towards. So we'll turn to each other for about 12 minutes, and then we'll harvest in the large room, harvest the voices, and we'll also get a chance to look at and practice visual resonance on the image that Olaf has been starting. So we will turn to each other and enjoy our time together. See you back here in about 12 minutes. Welcome back, everyone. I feel myself just like beaming from my breakout conversation. So I hope that you had a joyful or whatever it needed to be for you breakout. And we can do a couple things to just get some voices in. We can type directly in the chat and share it, just insights that may have come up. And we can also click on the reactions button if you're in Zoom, and click on raise hand, and we can hear a few voices from our group here, and then we'll check out Olaf's image before we close. So if anyone would like to share, feel free to use the raise hand.
Where is the raise hand button?
I think since you're already talking, we can try and find you. If you're on.
Okay, no, I'm not on a mute. This is Christiana.
Let me see.
It's under reactions.
There.
Okay, thank you.
Christiana, here we go. Okay. Go for it. Christiana, did you want to share?
Yes, I wanted to share the following observation. I never thought that in such a short period of time, I will meet three people or one person that is doing academically what I am doing. So she has an interest on my project and I have an interest in talking to a scientist. And then I saw that we have a much deeper connection with the people as the other two ladies in the group were doing amazing work that has to do with changing the world. So I think that this is giving us an absolute certainty that we are not alone in this, that we are together. We might not know it, but it's manifesting around the globe. So I'm very thankful that this is happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Christiana. We'll bring up Salvador next.
Hi, as Christiana said, it's something amazing to see how people from different parts of the world, we are all of us with the same a big connection with this intention of regenerating the soil. We work here in Valencia in a small town, named Salval. We work with the people to collectively to compost the organic waste, domestic organic waste, and then to regenerate our land. And it's unbelievable how every time I enter in such a spaces, I'm connecting with people who is doing something similar. So I feel very, very strong with a clear intention, and I would like to achieve a global conscience awareness about the necessity of this regeneration, and the key, I think, is the compost. Thank you.
Thank you, Salvador. We'll take one or two more if we can. Natasha, we'll bring you next.
Hi, everyone. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, wherever you are in the world. It was really lovely and surprising, actually, because when we entered the breakout room, it was a Russian room, and I'm of a Russian origin living in Mauritius. And it's amazing how these type of projects, they bring together people from all over the world, all of us with different stories, and how every little step that we make every day of our lives brings us closer together to a more cleaner and more healthy future. I look after people's well-being and healthy eating culture, not a diet. But that also brings in sustainable food development, sustainable food growth, a lovely environment. And we were discussing that in a breakout room with the lady. So everything is interconnected. And it's really lovely, surprising, heartwarming to see that manifesting here tonight. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Natasha. And we have a YouTube user who is watching the live stream as well. So Henry shared, I feel like nature is screaming for us to let it live. We were born on this planet and we're an integral part of it, but we're disconnected. I feel pain, forgetfulness and need to reconnect. And I'd like to thank you, Henry, and thank you everyone for even just beginning this conversation. It feels like we will have another session in just about an hour and a half, and we continue the conversation there. So I encourage us to join that in just an hour and a half. But for now, I'd like to turn it over to Olaf, who is in Berlin and has been painting, drawing up from our conversation today. So Olaf, what have you been seeing and sensing? And maybe we can take a look at your image as well.
Thank you, Antoinette. I think for me, which followed throughout the conversation, was the fire that was very impressive for me, because actually just the understanding fire instead of fighting it that kept running in my head, because I realized how, but it's really about understanding. It's not about, you know, that's all. I cannot put it into words, it's too close. But
thank you. Thank you, Olaf. And thank you for capturing this in this way. For us here. So what I'd like to invite us to do is, if you're in Zoom, you can click on view in the top right corner and full screen. And just be with this image together for a moment and just notice, we do this practice of visual resonance. So just noticing what's resonating for you from the image that you see on the screen and the conversation that we've had here. Just noticing what you see, what you sense, and what you feel. And as is already happening in the chat, we can share in the chat on Zoom or on YouTube using the prompts, I see, I sense, and I feel. Jero will read a few of them out.
I see the white and pure smoke of the fire. I see a path on soil. I see a dancer in the fire. I sense collective emergence. I sense purification and regeneration. I see a white flame that cleanses, allowing the roots to grow and expand. I feel a huge sense of possibility. I sense the urgency. I sense renewal. I sense moving forward. I see the future ignited. I sense the bird of a totem animal. I feel the heart of the land. I see dancing. I feel the urge to connect to nature again. I sense a new world coming out of this all. I sense running into a wall. I feel longing.
Thank you, Jero. Thank you all. There's so much power in this session and in this resonance practice. And there's a lot that I'm still sitting with. So I'm glad we have another hour and a half together in just an hour and a half. So I feel like we're taking a little break now. But that said, there is so much to be grateful for in this session. To Oral McGuire and the community and people and land that you have brought to us and this global community today. To Katie and John for making the connections and the work that you all are doing with Danjukurling. And to Commonland, our great partner, and Dieter and Peter, who represented and shared today the great work that you are doing to regenerate the land in different parts of the world and make that work for, with all of us. We will be having continued sessions. So this is just the beginning of Earth Month, but also of the conversation. So we will have, for those interested, a soil circle. So we will be continuing the conversation with Commonland on May 18th. And the way that you can connect in with that is through Sutra. So Sutra is our platform for continued dialogue and discussion throughout the month and in between our GAIA sessions. This circle is specifically about soil and really continuing the threads of this conversation. And we will have language tracks. So in various places around the world and in various communities that connect through language, we will be sharing in German, Spanish, French, Portuguese, Russian, and Japanese. And we will be hosting those sessions with the various language leaders and their teams. You can find those dates and times. There's a lot, otherwise I would read them all out on GAIAjourney.org. And each of these sessions is really especially important now as we turn to our own places and consider how we might walk together with Oral and the Nyungar community in our own places. So a really warm and heartfelt thank you to you all. Thank you, everyone. And I note that GAIA, as much as it stands for Global Activation of Intention and Action, is also quite clearly a reference to GAIA and Mother Earth. So thank you also to our great Mother Earth for holding us and allowing us to have this conversation as well. We can all unmute and say goodbye. And we'll see
bye.
You. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Deep appreciation for all this work. Thank you.
Namaste.
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 Thanks. Muchas gracias.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I love you.